Very good morning and warm welcome to Department of Chemical Engineering at IIT Bombay. So this is a 3-day workshop which we are organizing through TechWhip project. So we have at IIT Bombay a project called KIT, Knowledge Incubation under TechWhip, in which we are supposed to support, mentor TechWhip colleges in Maharashtra. And as a part of that, part of mentoring activity of education and research in these colleges, we are organizing this workshop. So in this 3-day workshop, you will be exposed to a variety of research frontiers in chemical engineering. You will get to see our labs, you will get to interact with our students, you will come to know about the facilities at IIT, and more important than that, you will make friends. You will make friends with students here, you will make friends among yourselves. We have students coming from many colleges from Maharashtra. So this includes LIT Nagpur, Tatya Saheb Kore Institute of Technology from Varnanagar, then University Institute of Chemical Technology, Jalgaon, ICT Mumbai, Jawaharlal Darda Institute of Engineering and Technology, Yavatmal, VNIT Nagpur, Baba Saheb Ambedkar Technological University, Lonere, SGGS Institute of Engineering and Technology, Nanded, and VIT Pune. So about 10 colleges in Maharashtra. These are all leading institutes in Maharashtra. These are represented here. And most of you are doing either postgraduate studies, first year, second year of your MTech or ME program. Some of the students are from their fourth year of chemical engineering, BTech. Some have already registered for their PhD and pursuing their PhD. So it's a gathering of, you know, those who are interested in pursuing research in chemical engineering. Now, chemical engineering research has transformed dramatically over the last few years, and the idea is to introduce you to these. So very warm welcome again. I'll take this opportunity to welcome Professor Gadre, who is head of CDEEP, and he is in charge of this project for TechWhip, and head chemical engineering, Professor K.V. Venkatesh. I'll request now Professor Venkatesh to give a introductory talk about research in chemical engineering. Before that, I'll request Professor Gadre to say a few words about the program.
So let me once again extend a very warm welcome to all of you. I am in the Department of Electrical Engineering. I am here today in my capacity as the head for the Center for Distance Engineering Education, or CDEEP as it is called in short, at IIT Bombay. And CDEEP is the, you may call it, department or unit which is handling this whole activity of MHRD TechWhip kit in short, or the Technical Education Quality Improvement Program Nodal Center at IIT Bombay. So I just want to say a few words to you to give you the context of this program in the broader sense of the institute and perhaps even the ministry. The Ministry of Human Resources Development, which of course looks after many of your institutes and definitely ours, is keen to involve the IITs in executing this very important World Bank project called TechWhip. TechWhip is the Technical Education Quality Improvement Program. How many of you have heard of TechWhip? Can I see your hands, please? Yeah, you must have, because you know you are in institutes where this program is being executed. Now, the Technical Education Quality Improvement Program, or TechWhip as it is called for short, it's better known as TechWhip actually, is an initiative by the World Bank to make a significant difference to the higher education in the country. So it's not meant for primary or school education, but for college education, that too for technical quality, you know, college education, technical education, both at the undergraduate and postgraduate level. And under this program, several institutes have been supported. If I am not mistaken, there are about 180 or 190 institutes all over the country which have been supported under this TechWhip. So the TechWhip program is meant essentially for you know, raising the level of education, research, placement, and what have you, all the activities that, all the academic activities and to some extent even administrative, academic and academic administrative activities which an institution of higher learning can envisage. That is the purpose of the TechQuip program. The IITs, of course, are fortunate in many ways. They have always begun on a very good note and they have always been reputed in the country. So, quite correctly, the ministry did not envisage supporting the IITs under TechQuip. So, let us not mistake IIT to be a TechQuip institute, that is not what it means. However, recently, maybe last year, the ministry thought that the IIT should host what they called a quality circle or some kind of a nodal center for activities under TechQuip, which should bring together students, faculty and administrators from TechQuip institutes mapped to the IIT. For example, IIT Bombay has several institutes in Maharashtra and in and around Mumbai mapped to it, right. So, all of you are, you know, in some sense your institutes are mapped to IIT Bombay, and therefore, we would like to organize certain nodal programs. Nodal programs meaning programs which bring all of you together, as Professor Sachin Patwardhan said, to interact with one another, to interact with faculty and students in this institute, and also to build, you know, take away from here things that you like in terms of culture, practices and thoughts. Now, there are two parts of the TechQuip program. There are, you see, there was so called TechQuip 1, which was, I think, more focused on undergraduate education, and TechQuip 2, which is what is running now, is more focused, more I would say, not entirely, but more focused on higher level, that is graduate level, postgraduate, PhD and master's education. That is the reason why we are giving a little more fillip to the postgraduate activity under this nodal center. How many of you are PhD students? Okay, how many of you are faculty? None. How many of you are master students? Okay, that is very nice. So, you have a sizable number of all. Now, to the PhD students, I would like to emphasize that this is your chance to learn what is called research pedagogy, I mean whatever you want to call it. You see, you of course are working on specific themes in your PhD in your respective institutes, but there is a certain culture of an institution, a good institution, which helps a PhD student grow in all senses of the term. That is something which you need to carry away from IIT Bombay, in addition to the specific research thoughts that you will get by interacting with the students here. To the master students, I would like to mention that this is your chance to understand what it means to have research activity in a department. Our Department of Chemical Engineering, I must inform you, is very highly reputed for its contributions to research and development in the country. There are people of great renown, all faculty here are of great renown in chemical engineering, and it is your privilege to be able to talk to them for the next 3 days. Please make the very best of this opportunity. And finally, but not the least, I would like you to encourage your colleagues from other departments in your institute, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, perhaps, you know, civil engineering, I do not know, whatever disciplines are there. Well, when I say electrical, I mean electrical, electronics, communication and so on, right. We would like to have similar programs in the future for such departments too, and we would definitely want you to spread the word that your friends should participate in programs that we organize in future under MHRD TechQuip, KIT, Knowledge Incubation under TechQuip. I would not like to take any more time, but once again welcome you very warmly. Make the very best of these 3 days, talk to the PhD students in chemical engineering faculty, interact among yourselves and carry away very pleasant and fruitful memories with you of this visit and this workshop. Thank you.
So, good morning to all. So, in the next 15-20 minutes, I will try to introduce, you know, the Department of Chemical Engineering at IIT Bombay. So, before I do that, I would just like to say something about what is research and what motivates some of us to do research. Okay. So, there are some BTECs here, MTECs and PhD students. So the PhD students have a reason as to why they are doing PhD. Okay, so there is some drive or motivation for them to do research. So the MTechs, they get some exposure to what research is with a small project. But typically these projects are very well defined by your guides, and then you just go through, you know, some problem solving, okay, through the, so it is something like an extended projects. If the BTechs have a project to do in their final year, it is something like an extended BTech project, but most of the help you get from your advisor or your guide to do the research. But research at the PhD level or the fundamental research that you want to carry out, okay, is slightly more than just doing a project. Okay, so there is a process of learning how to do research by your own, an independent research, how one can do. So that learning process happens during the PhD process. And so in the next 3 days, you will listen to faculty, and when you interact with our own PhD students, one of the things that you need to take home is, what does a research entail? Okay, so there is a process of identifying an area, right, in which area that you want to do research. And then you will have to come down to defining a problem. Okay, so that is very important, you know, what is the problem statement that you are going to define. Okay, so once you do literature survey and find out, you know, what is the status that a particular area is at, there will be open questions, challenges that throws up. So you need to define this problem. And then now you want to address it. So you start with a hypothesis, that this is the hypothesis I'm going to target and solve in the next 4 years through research. So that then you'll have to plan experiments and methodologies as to how are you going to address it. Okay. Then collect data, you're going to do analysis of that, and then you'll prove or disprove the hypothesis with which you started. So this process, a fundamental process of doing research, is what I think you should take home. Okay. And then get excited, some of you, and then go on to do PhDs and get into a research career. Okay, so that's the goal of, I think, the next 3 days, whatever you're going to experience. And in that process, we are going to expose you to, specifically to the Department of Chemical Engineering at IIT Bombay. So I'll just tell you what are the research in the broad theme, and the lectures during the next 3 days are going to give you details of each areas that we have at the Department of Chemical Engineering. So just to introduce, this is one of the key departments of IIT Bombay since its inception in 1958. So the department initially had more a technology flavor, but in the recent past it has become more engineering science flavor. Okay, more fundamental work is going on. It's one of the largest departments in the institute in terms of number of faculty, students enrolled, and research funding received. So like any other educational institute, so the department has a mission and a vision. So you can see that research is one of the main mission of our department. So we want to develop a dynamic research program, and you will see in the next 3 days that our department has a lot of dynamic research that is going on to contribute towards the fundamentals of chemical engineering science, okay, and to industrial practice. And obviously education is also one of our goals. So we have a dynamic postgraduate program, a strong emphasis on basic and applied research. And when you interact with our own PhD students and master's students, and you will get a feel for the kind of education that we have in our department. So we have industry interaction, okay, and we try to keep in touch with the alumni because we do get inputs from them. So the current departmental strength is that we have about 40 faculty in our department. So there are 7 postdoctoral students, and then we are trying to increase this number. And we have a total of 787 students, with you can see that we have about 174 PhD students, which is a large number of PhD students working in different areas. So we have institute staff, about 25, and the project staff who work under various projects, okay, from the DST and the DBT, the projects that we get. So we have quite a large number of project staff specifically working on projects. So the degree programs are, as you may be aware, that we have BTech, BTech MTech dual degree, and then just MTech, MTech PhD. So we have a combined MTech PhD program, and then you have the doctoral, okay, the PhD program. So this is the current student intake that we have in terms of breakup, which I had already shown in terms of BTEC, MTEC, and the PhD students. So you will see that we keep updating new courses as you know a new faculty comes in or there is a area which is picked up, okay, which is coming up. So we keep upgrading with you know with new courses that we keep changing as you know area develops. And you will see that we have got several new topics like molecular principles in chemical engineering, you know, introduction to systems biology, aerosol technology. So all these upcoming areas. So we have new courses that we develop as we go along. So there are academy and industry interactions in terms of, you know, there are adjunct faculty who come from outside and teach and interact with our students. And not only that, we have visiting faculty from international and national other institutes. You will see that we have at least from 2 weeks to a month, there are faculty coming and spending time in our department. And this also helps in the expansion of, you know, the research culture in the department. And our faculty also go abroad on short terms. So we'll see that to leading universities, our faculty have been visiting and spending some time there and coming back. So we have been having a steady increase in the PhD student growth. So essentially indicating that the research component in the department is, you know, is increasing year by year. So the PhD program, we have a minimum 4 courses for students holding master's degree and about 8 courses if student can join after their BTEC. So students from BTEC can also join directly to PhD into our department. And so this is the steady increase in the last 5-6 years that we have in the intake of our PhD students. So approximately 30 students join every year for PhD program in our department. And we also have a program where a MTech, currently MTech at IIT Bombay can shift to a PhD. So that number is also increasing. So at least 5 to 6 MTech students now choose to you know, continue and do PhD in our department, okay, continue to do PhD. So this is the graduating PhD year-wise. So we have about average about 5 to 5.5 years for the student to graduate. And this is the numbers in the last 4 or 5 years. So we have been having about 15 to 20 PhD students graduating every year. And this number is going to increase because the PhD, net PhD strength in the department is going on increasing. Okay. So currently we have about 174 PhD students as I indicated. So we have core research groups in the department, and these are the research groups that you're going to see talks, you know, in the next 3 days. So we have biological systems engineering, you know, including biotechnology, biochemical engineering and systems biology, and biomaterials and biomedical engineering. So these are the core areas that form in the biological systems engineering. We have soft matter, process systems engineering, catalysis and reaction engineering, thermodynamics and molecular simulations, energy and environment. So these are the core areas in which our department does research in. So in biological systems engineering, for example, I'd indicated we have about 12 faculty members working in this area. Biotechnology, disease and health, biomaterials, data mining and analysis, dynamics and control of biological systems. So these are the areas in the biological systems engineering. In energy and environment, we have biomass and biofuels, fuel cells, solar thermal power, process modeling and energy catalysis, analysis, combustion systems, climate, environment and sustainability, and carbon capture systems. Thermodynamics and molecular simulations, materials, computer methods and bio-inspired systems. And in soft matter, colloids and interface engineering, granular and particulate flows, nanostructured materials, drug delivery and microfluidics. So in catalysis and reaction engineering, which is the core of chemical engineering, you have catalysis, reactor modeling, multiphase reaction, electrochemical reactions in fuel cells, processing of semiconductor materials, biofuels and clean coal technologies. And finally, the process systems engineering, you have control relevant modeling, nonlinear model predictive control, fault diagnosis, nonlinear state estimation, adaptive control, flow sheeting and process intensification. Okay, so these are the areas that are covered in our department. And you will see that in each of the areas, you have quite a number of faculty forming the core group. So everywhere you will see 8 to more than 10 faculty working in an area. So that brings in, you know, some, you know, a cluster of faculty doing similar research. That adds to, you know, the uplifting of a particular area in terms of people coming together. So R&D, I'll just give you, briefly cover that. We have most of our funding comes from sponsored projects. So we have a lot of sponsored projects. So most of our PhD students, other than the MHRD funded projects, we also take students from the sponsored projects to our PhD programs. So they're working on a project and are also doing PhD. So even that sponsored project funding has been going on increasing in the last 5-6 years, and then in 2013 we had close to 74 crores of total money that our department got just for research. So about average per faculty, we have about 75 lakhs. So each faculty gets about 75 lakhs of project money. So let me just skip some of these things. So one of the outputs that is measured is the publications that we have from the department. Although we should not go whole out in terms of the numbers, because numbers just indicate something that there is a but the quality of paper and how much citations that have, all that also is important. But just as an indicator, so we have about 100 publications per year from our department, okay, in the last 4-5 years. So we've got close to 100 publications. So this gives you about 3 papers per year per faculty. So every faculty at least publishes 3 papers in a year. So that's the kind of output that we have, and which also reflects in increased citations, okay, of the kind of work that our faculty is doing, close to 10 citations per year per faculty. So this is the kind of citations that we have from our department. So there are faculty members who have written books, book chapters and edited books. So this also reflects the pedagogy in the department. People are just not doing research, but also spending their time writing books. So these are some of the books that our department has published. So there have been some technologies also transferred to the industry because of the research that is going on. So till date, we have about 30, transferred, awarded and filed patents from our department. And some of these technologies have also been transferred to industry. So placement and career, which is also important. So our students have to be placed well. So I'll just indicate the M.Tech and the PhD, because that is where most of you are in. So we have about most of our M.Techs are all placed, and you will see that 56% go to core chemical engineering, okay, and then you have 10 who go to academia, to some of the institutes as faculty after their M.Tech, and then about 34% who go to other areas, like consultancy or computers and things like that, not in the core area. So this is the distribution for our M.Tech. And for our PhD placement, you will see that it is almost sort of equally distributed, that we have about 37 who go to postdoc abroad, okay, to other institute to do postdoc. There are 37% who go to industry and about 26% who go to academia as faculty. Okay, so this is the distribution among the PhD students who graduate from our department. So the PhD placements have been in postdocs in top universities in US, Europe, Singapore, Japan, and in corporate R&D, and you will see that the list of companies that are listed, so it almost reads most of the leading chemical and biochemical industries in the country. Okay, so most of them are placed in these industries in corporate R&D. And there are some who have gone to become faculty in IITs, NITs and NCSAR labs, for example, they are in NCL and things like that. Okay. So this is how our PhD students are placed. Most of them either in postdoc, in industry, or as faculty in academia. So the research also reflects in a lot of awards that our faculty have been winning. So I'll not go through it, I'll just list. You will see that we have fellows of national academies, and then we have got Bhatnagar Awards and JC Bose National Fellowship, Young Engineers Award, Young Scientist Award. So this is reflected in the quality of work that our faculty have been doing. And the other reflection in terms of the quality of research is how many are members of international peer reviewed journals. Okay, so you publish, so they recognize your quality and then make you the associate with a journal. So we have got quite a bit of actually 12 faculty members in various journals in the editorial board as associate editors or in the editorial boards. Okay, so you'll see Biotech Bioeng, Advanced Powder Technology, Journal of Chemical Technology and Biotechnology. So we are all editors in peer-reviewed journals. Okay, so this also sort of reflects the you know, the quality of work and then the some going on in the department. So just to summarize, I think the Department of Chemical Engineering has a vibrant academic and research culture, and I hope you will carry this and see for yourself, okay, the kind of work that is being done in the next 3 days. So there has been increasing focus on PG program and research, and this is evident in the number of PhD students and publications. So the industry interaction is also on the rise. And one of the advantages is in our department, more than half the faculty strength, they are all you know, less than 45 years, so it really makes it dynamic, because we have a young faculty member doing you know, contemporary research, and several faculty working in emerging research areas. So the future directions, you know, so our foci would be in doing research in molecule, at the molecule level, materials, systems and modeling. So it covers right from molecular level to the systems level. So the, all the broad facet of chemical engineering is covered. So there is a recent report by US Department of Defense, which talks about three themes which are going to be in the future in the next 10 to 15 years. And that has been the bottom of biochemical, chemical and material synthesis. So you design from bottom up. Better optimization method, so you deal at the systems level, so you have to account for large scale problems, so you need to account for system level. And then in silico discovery of material properties and processing routes. So do it on the computer first and then go on to do it actually in as experiments. So I think our department already has faculty working in all these areas at different levels. So and this will be a natural growth for our department also. So and we also have been modernizing our teaching and research labs with the project money that we get, and also from MHRD that we have recently got about 6 crores to modernize our labs that we have, and some of it you may see in the next 3 days. So with that, thank you, and then I hope that we will interact more in the next 3 days.
I would like to welcome Professor Avinash Amte, who is Head Academic Cell, SPFU of Maharashtra, that is Directorate of Technical Education. Welcome, Mr. Amte. Before we start the next program, I have a very brief announcement. We unfortunately, because of the rain, we started a little late today. We are about 25 minutes late. But every program in the workshop will start on the minute. Okay, so we'll now try to adjust for this half an hour. We'll see how to compensate for it. But all the rest of the programs will exactly start by minute. So, for example, afternoon we have lab visits, and we precisely start at 1:45. Okay, so please make sure that you are you come to the hall or you come to the place where you're supposed to start exactly at the time. Okay. So the first lecture today is by Professor Supreet Saini. Supreet Saini is Assistant Professor of Chemical Engineering. He has recently joined our department about an year ago. 2 years? Almost, 2 years ago. So Supreet did his undergraduate BTech from Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, and then moved on to do MS and PhD at University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. So after finishing his PhD in 2010, he had a brief stint at IIT Gandhinagar for 1.5 years, and after that he decided to move to IIT Bombay. His research areas are systems biology, bacterial pathogenesis, bioremediation and dynamics of complex systems. And he has received many awards. I'll just list two important awards here. Innovative Young Biotechnologist Award of DBT, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, and Richard Murray Wilkestein Award of American Society of Microbiology. So Professor Saini will be introducing to you to frontier research that is going on in the area of biosystems engineering and biomaterials. And towards the end, he'll also indicate what's going on in our department. So I hand over to Supreet.
Morning, everybody. and thanks Sachin for introducing, although seems to have disappeared. Anyway, so next hour or so we are going to talk about biology and how does chemical engineering fit into biology. I was trained as a chemical engineer and absolutely hated biology. I'm guessing many of you are the same. So how many of us find biology extremely boring? Be honest, it can't be just that many hands. Has to be more than that. It's full of cramming, it's boring, right? So what I'll try to do over the next hour or so is try to communicate what's going on in biology right now, contemporary research, what are the issues that people are working on, why is it so exciting, and how does chemical engineering fit into biology, and how can we contribute as chemical engineers when it comes to solving some of the problems that biologists are facing. Just as a show of hands, how many of us 10th standard was the last time we did biology? Just higher, okay. 12th, and has anybody had a course after they started undergrad in a course in biology? One person, okay, good, okay. So again, for this to be worthwhile, please ask questions. Please stop me wherever you are stuck. I will also ask some questions, and. Anywhere, if you feel lost, if I'm going too slow, too fast, this is going to be half pedagogical and half some of the research issues. Please feel free to interrupt, and it's not important to cover everything that I have here, but it's more important to, that you take away something from this lecture. So let's try to do that in the next hour or so. Okay. So we start with the very, very basics. DNA is called the blueprint of life, right? All of our cells have a DNA, which is just a very long polymer. Okay. All of us understand polymers, and DNA in our body is 3 billion monomers long. Okay. For different species, the length of the polymer might be different. For human beings, it's about 3 billion monomers long polymer that exists in every single cell of my body. Where am I getting my DNA from? I'm getting it from my parents, right? You're getting it from your parents. And every single cell of my body has the same DNA. The polymer sequence is the same in every cell of my body. You and I would have small differences when it comes to the polymer sequences, but essentially across human beings, the length is conserved and the sequence is conserved. So immediately there is a problem, I'm talking of billions of sequence data here. I need computational power to be able to analyze all this data. I can't read 3 billion monomers long sequence and try to make sense of it. Okay. So immediately you see that there is scope for data analysis, data mining, identifying genetic disease when DNA sequences go wrong, and so on and so forth. Okay. But what makes us, so DNA is called blueprint of life, right? Has anybody heard that DNA is the blueprint of life? Okay, some people have. What do you mean by DNA is the blueprint of life? Yeah, you. Right. So why do I look the way I look? How can I move my hands? Why do I have a brain? Because my DNA dictates what proteins are going to form in my body. And all cellular functions are carried out by proteins in my body. Okay. So let's say if you talk of a horse, our horse has different DNA. The sequence, the monomer sequence of the DNA is different in a horse. So the kind of proteins that a horse makes are going to be different from the kind of proteins that exist in my body and your body. Okay. So proteins carry out all the functions inside the cell, be it structural, be it catalyzing enzymes and all other functions. And DNA dictates what kind of proteins are formed in my body. Okay. Does that make sense? Okay, and this process is called the central dogma of biology, because this is really critical to what's happening inside our organism. If DNA goes wrong, if DNA goes wrong, you don't get the correct proteins, and then that may lead to diseases, however serious, or even fatal diseases. Okay. On the right here, this is a. So we've talked about reactors, right? We all do reaction engineering. One way to look at a living cell is look at it like a reactor. Okay. many of these proteins are actually catalysts which catalyze many reactions. So glucose gives us energy, all of us know that, right? But how does glucose give energy? It's not as if every cell sets fire to glucose and it oxidizes into CO2, and it has to very carefully oxidize to CO2 and H2O, right? And with this is accompanied by release of energy. That catalysis of glucose to carbon dioxide happens in a series of steps, and that those reactions are carried out by these proteins. And this map here is the sum total of all the reactions that are occurring in a single human cell. Okay. Now, as chemical engineers, we normally don't see chemical reactors of this complexity. I mean, you can't make any sense out of it, and that's the idea, that it's impossible to make any sense out of it. So, if I were to ask you to analyze the performance of this reactor, it's almost impossible, right? How do you even deal with the complexity of this size? Okay. So that's the two things. One is DNA dictates what proteins are going to be formed, and proteins are going to catalyze each one of these reactions which exist in every single cell of our body. Okay. Does that make sense? Again, this is just that picture enlarged. You still can't make out anything. There are literally thousands of reactions that are happening inside our body. Okay. So these are different type of cells that exist in our body. So I have said that all my cells have the same exact sequence, DNA sequence, which I acquired from my parents, right? The sperm and the egg meet, they form the zygote, and the same cell divides, and every cell in my body acquires the same DNA from the parent cell which was formed at the time of birth, right? So if every cell has the same DNA, and DNA dictates what proteins are formed inside the body, why is it that a cell on my tongue and a cell in my eye look very different? Okay, is the question clear? All cells in my body have the same DNA. We have said DNA is the blueprint of life, and DNA dictates what kind of proteins are going to be formed inside the cell, right? So if all cells have same DNA, they should make the same proteins, but then why is it that different cells of cells from different parts of my body look very, very different from each other? They should look identical, right? I mean common sense tells us that should be the case. Why? I mean, these are some of the examples. It's not very clear, but I mean, you can pick any part of your body and see the cells are very different, right? Why? Yes. Correct. That's correct. So now we saw this exceptionally complex reactor that's present in every cell of my body, right? To make matters even more complex, what's happening is that different cells of my body are making different sets of proteins. Okay, so this is sum total of all the reactions, but not all the reactions are on all the time. Some of the reactions are not happening in a cell. So for instance, for a cell in my tongue, the reaction that gives white color to my cell in the eye may not be happening, hence it's pink in color. Okay, so that reaction is only happening in the cell which are present inside my eye. That leads us to the next question, that how does a cell know if it's on my tongue, on my hand, or in my eye? How does a cell know? Any thoughts about that? Is the question clear? Right? I mean, every cell is different, so there has to be a mechanism for the cell to find out where am I located and then make appropriate proteins. I mean, it doesn't make sense for this cell to form white protein. So how does a cell know? Yeah. Perfect. So at the time of conception, when a sperm meets an egg, you have one cell. Our body is one cell, right? And anybody wants to take a wild guess as to how many cells does your body or my have at this moment? What's the order of magnitude that we are looking at? I mean, go wild. I mean, guess anything, doesn't matter. What is that? Yeah, a few trillion cells, 8 to 10 trillion cells of a fully grown adult. Okay. So you are going from one cell to about a trillion cells in a very few years. Okay. And all these cells develop differently. We talked about this reaction network. The cells on my hand only have one part of this reaction network which is active, the other is off. The cells in my eye have another part of the reaction network that's on, the other is off. Okay. So now this leads us to a control problem, that as the cell is dividing from 1 to 2 leading to a 10 trillion assortment of cells, it needs to divide correctly, it needs to program correctly that the correct proteins, the correct reactions should be active in the correct cells. That's a great controls problem now. Okay. So that's what the different set of proteins that are expressed in my body in different cells, that's an exclusive group, that's not exclusive, it's a different group, and that leads to that's a reason why different cells of my body look differently. Does that make sense? Okay. There's an interesting story. There is a very famous evolutionary biologist at Oxford. His name is Richard Dawkins. Okay. So he's a big proponent of evolution. He's an evolutionary biologist, and he wants to convince people that it wasn't God that made human beings. Human beings have evolved from the simplest of life forms, increasing in complexity over hundreds of millions of years, and then eventually leading us to our present form. So he was giving one of these lectures, and one lady got up and said that you are saying that from one cell, from a single cell, that life originated as a single cell. And this lady said that you are telling me that from this one cell, evolution ensured that I evolved, I mean, such a complex being evolved from one cell in a few hundred million years, that doesn't sound plausible. And his answer to that was that it's very much plausible. You did it, I did it, everybody else did it in 9 months. Right? Because 9 months when we were conceived, we were one cell, but 9 months later, we had this extremely complex form. So why not give nature 100 million years to accomplish the same thing? Fine. Okay. I think this is fine. Okay. So now another question. Cells are very smart. Okay. Let's talk of a very simple system. I'm a bacteria. Okay. If I'm a bacteria, you give me glucose, I'm very happy. I will use that glucose to release energy, right? I'm doing that. But if you take away my glucose, and of course, to be able to utilize that glucose, I need to express the correct proteins, which will catalyze the reaction of glucose leading up to release of carbon dioxide and oxygen and carbon dioxide and water and energy, right? Does that make sense? I need to express those proteins. Now, if you take away glucose from me, does it make any sense for me to produce those proteins anymore, which help me release energy from glucose? It doesn't make any sense, because if glucose is not around, what am I going to do with that energy, right? So I should not make those proteins. If you give me glucose again, I should again start making these proteins, right? If you throw antibiotic at me, I should take steps to be able to tackle against that antibiotic and protect myself against those antibiotics, right? If you take away that antibiotic from me, there is no need for me to take any protective action. I should not waste my energy producing any or taking any steps to protect myself when there is no antibiotic around. It's a waste of energy, right? So every living cell does that. Bacteria also do that, right? They respond dynamically to the changing environmental conditions, okay? Again, a dynamics problem. What are the kinetics of this thing happening? How fast is the change happening? How slow is the fast change happening? Is it controllable? How sensitive it is to the system? How finely or coarsely is it dependent on the sensitivity of the parameters that are involved? Things that we as chemical engineers understand, right? So how is this information conveyed is really critical to understand before we go into the kind of problems that we deal with in chemical engineering, in biosystems engineering. So for this, I need to measure, for me to realize that there is glucose outside and I should start producing proteins which help me eat glucose, there should be a mechanism to sense, right? There needs to be a sensor. So the first step in anything is a signaling system, which is a protein embedded in the membrane, which will sense any environmental stimulus that you give the cell. Could be glucose, could be antibiotics, could be anything. Okay? That's the first step. So this is called signaling. This guy signals, of course, glucose is outside, this signals, and then this, obviously, this will convey the information from outside the cell to the inside the cell, right? Inside the cell, you're processing that signal that has been communicated to the inside of the cell, that you tell the DNA that glucose is around. DNA will say, okay, if glucose is around, start making proteins which will help me use that glucose and release energy and grow eventually. So you start making this protein, and next this protein will then catalyze this reaction, or a series of reactions in this case, where glucose will get oxidized to carbon dioxide with release of energy. Okay. So what's important to see here is that there are three steps, and these three steps can be switched on or can be switched off. Okay. For instance, if I remove the signal, this part goes away, this part then goes away. There is no protein then, and then the cell, there is no protein, there is no utilization of glucose. When glucose comes again, the signal is again fed into the system, right? So it's like transfer of information. Okay. Information is being signaled from outside to inside the cell. It's being processed at the DNA level, and then there are chemical reactions which are being catalyzed by the proteins that are being made inside the cell. Okay. Does that make sense? So that's a very fundamental broad course picture that we are looking at when we are talking of information processing inside a cell. Okay. If you've been with me so far, I'll talk about the four or five major areas in which research is happening in bio across the world. Okay. Before we do that, any questions? It could be anything, okay. Don't be hesitant. Okay. Yeah.
Different body parts to different functions.
What is that?
Different body parts.
Right.
To different functions.
Correct.
Then we can analyze this body part do this function.
Right.
Then secrete the protein and catalyze the reaction by different steps.
Right. So okay, I didn't answer my question. The question was that how do different body parts recognize? How does a liver cell know that it's a liver cell and not a eye cell? Right. So the answer to that is the cell senses that by the immediate environmental conditions that are surrounding it. So the environment here is very different from environment in my tongue, inside my mouth, and environment in my eye. So the cells sense the environment that's present here. What do they use to sense that environment? That same step number one. They use this to sense the kind of environment that's present in the vicinity, then make appropriate proteins, and hence different cells look have a different physical and chemical appearance. Okay. Does that answer your question? Okay. Okay. So the first one is very sort of engineering like, which is if you have to talk about metabolic engineering. Metabolism is a term used which is a collective, which is a collection of all chemical reactions that are happening inside the cell. Okay. We looked at that very, very complex network inside the cell. That's a sum total of all reactions that are happening inside the cell, right? So metabolic engineering is, can we tweak that system? So first part is understanding a system. We need to understand that. And there are various, you know, reaction type analysis techniques to be able to do that, to understand metabolism inside a cell. The first step is that we need to understand that what does this mean? I mean, it's a very, very complex mess. What does it mean in terms of cell processing these chemicals? Then you want to understand that because you want to design systems so that improve yield of products, which could be of commercial interest. So one of them could be a biofuel. Okay. So there is a lot of effort going on in the direction that you engineer microorganisms, yeast or bacteria, so as to enhance the production of ethanol or butanol that they are producing as a result of fermentation. So many organisms, when they grow in the absence of oxygen, they produce these alcohols, which could be used as fuels. Right. For this, to be able to improve yield of these, you use these bioreactors like this. So you study the sensitivity of the performance of the organism in terms of production of this chemical of interest. When you vary parameters like pH, temperature, what is the composition of media, how many nutrients are you feeding them, at what rate are you feeding them, what is the RPM, and how do you scale it up to a bigger industrial unit, are some of the more engineering type problems that you work with when you're dealing with metabolic engineering. To be able to do this, you do metabolic analysis, and there are various computational tools, because now we are talking of a reaction network which is thousands in scale. Okay, it's very large network, and you need to be able to, you know, tune that, to understand that taken together, and hence you need these computational techniques. And the next is that, can you, once you understand these networks, can you change them now to be able to enhance the yield or make it faster, and so on and so forth. And the last bit is that, can you incorporate novel features that say a bacteria or a yeast doesn't even make ethanol, okay, it's not present in nature, but can I change the metabolic network, can I add reactions by manipulating DNA so that I add reactions which would enable the organism to make ethanol now. That's what's called a genetically engineered organism. So now you have an organism which couldn't make ethanol, making ethanol, and then you repeat these steps to try and optimize the production of whatever chemical is of interest to you. That makes sense. Okay. So second is systems analysis, which is really so we talked about sugar and antibiotic. I see sugar, I need to produce proteins which would help me use this sugar, right? I see antibiotics, I need to produce something to be able to enable me to combat these antibiotics. All this is processed inside a cell. Let me call that in a network, in a regulatory, what's called a regulatory network. Okay, that's depicted by this green box. So if you are trying to respond to something, okay, let's imagine you are the bacteria and you have antibiotics sprayed on you. What are the features that you would be interested in? I could think of one, that you would want the response to be very fast, right? You wouldn't want to, whatever protection mechanism is there, to take on 5 hours to come on. You would want it to happen fast, right? Can we think of something else? It should be cheap. It shouldn't be that I'm producing 10,000 proteins to produce one unit of the useful thing that I'm looking at, right? So in terms of the cost that the cell is paying to be able to combat this antibiotic, the cost should be really small. Then the system should be stable, right? We talk about stability in dynamical analysis. It should be reproducible. The response should be reproducible. It should be sensitive. It should have appropriate sensitivity. Like if you give it a little bit of antibiotic, the response should also be commensurate with what you are giving. If you are giving it a lot of antibiotic, the response should also be equally large to be able to combat what you are throwing at it. How does it, biological signals are very noisy, and I'll just leave it at that. And dynamic response in terms of how fast does it come on, when you remove the antibiotic, how fast does it come off. So these are parameters which you typically, which would be of interest to any system that you are looking at, okay. Same in living organisms. So one of the, let me show you a little movie. What was that? Looks like a sperm. It's actually a bacterial cell which is swimming in a liquid media, swimming in glucose. So they use these flagella bacteria, which are like oars of a boat, to swim in liquid media. Just to give you a representative example of a problem in this kind. Now, if it's swimming, it's swimming at a certain speed. What are the kind of problems that people are interested in? And a lot of people are interested in flagella. This is like hundreds of people across the world look at how does bacteria build flagella. So something that you're interested in is the fluid mechanics of the problem. How is it able to swim? material science, what is the flagella made of and how does it, the structural polymer drives the cell forward. Obviously, the dynamics and control of assembly of flagella is a very important problem. Flagella are often 10 times bigger than me. So, if I am one bacteria, my flagella would be 10 times bigger than me. How do I control something which is 10 times bigger than me and away from my body? Okay, that's a problem. It's actually also an interesting debate among evolutionary biologists and creationists. Creationists are people who would say that God made everything, and they said that something as complex as flagella could not have evolved by evolution. There has to have been some intervention by intelligence design. God must have intervened and made flagella, hence God exists. Evolutionary biologists try to disprove them and say that no, it could have evolved through these mechanisms. Okay. Third is, remember we at the start we talked about very large sequences. So there are lots of species now. You want to understand which species belongs here, who is the neighbor of whom, who descended from whom, and so on and so forth. But first, what is evolution? Right. Continuous development. What is that? Okay. And how does evolution work? What is that? I'm looking for something more specific than that. Right. So here is how it works. You need two things for evolution to happen. One is variation, right? That when I produce progenies, my progenies should be, there should be some difference between me and my progenies. If they are exactly identical, if their DNA is exactly identical to mine, evolution is not going to happen because they are the same as me. That's one thing. There should be variability, and that's incorporated in nature by the machine that copies my DNA for my progeny. That machine makes a mistake. At a given frequency, that machine makes a mistake. So the progeny's DNA is going to be slightly different from my DNA. Okay. And the second thing that's needed for evolution to happen is selection. That now you have these variants. My progenies all have slightly different DNAs. Some are slightly more suited to survive in this environment. Some are slightly less suited to survive in this environment. Nature plays its course, and the ones which are more suited to survive in this environment, by chance, by random chance, because the mistakes were happening by chance, the ones which are slightly more suited to survive will flourish. The ones which are slightly less suited will lose because of competition, and that's what Darwin called selection of the fittest. Okay, so you need these two things to happen. Of course, we started from a single cell, and down there are millions of species probably. You need to connect them. So a lot of bioinformatics and is done in sequence analysis to try and discern from sequences of organisms, these millions of organisms, to see who is the neighbor of whom, who evolved from whom, what was the lineage, what was the tree-like structure that evolved during evolution. So this is what it looks like. Okay, you evolved from a common ancestor, and then everybody branched their own way, leading us to where we are right now. But does that make sense? This is a common ancestor from which all life originated, and then everybody branched because of evolution, and now we have the diversity that we have right now. Okay. All of us have heard of Darwin, right? Darwin was the one who proposed evolution, and this is my favorite picture ever. This is from Darwin's notes, where he drew a tree. He was just hypothetically assuming that A would evolve from B, the tree would branch out, and so on and so forth, which is, remarkably similar to what we have found out some 150 years later with all the technology that we had. He figured it out in the 19th century. And what I like most about this picture is that on the top left of this picture, he writes, "I think this is what's going on." And it's pretty remarkable that that was what was going on. Okay. This was 19th century, but turns out there was another guy who actually predicted evolution about 2200 years before Darwin. And in his notes, he says, "The infinite variety in life can be arranged in a continuous series in which each link is indistinguishable from the next." What he's saying is that my progenies are going to be slightly different than me. It's going to be a very small change that happens from one generation to another. Their progenies are going to slightly be different from their progenies. So there is going to be this evolutionary chain which is going to be slightly different from each other, leading to very large differences when I look across many generations. Okay. Anybody wants to guess who was this? What was that? Yes, it was Aristotle. Okay. This is 320 BC or so. This is from Aristotle's books. Okay. So the kind of problems that you're interested in, can we make this evolutionary tree given two species? Can we try to figure out, again, a sequence analysis? Lot of bioinformatics and data mining goes in this exercise, speciation. And then if I were to tell you that this is a genetic disease and I give you sequence of 10 patients and 10 healthy individuals, can you tell me where are the differences, which are the crucial differences which are leading to these genetic diseases among human beings or any species that we're interested in? Okay. I guess I'll be quickly wind this up. Next part is biomaterials, which is developing materials now for health application. This is biomedical engineering. So if I have a joint replacement, if I need an artificial substrate to grow stuff on, if I'm looking at stem cell differentiation, this is where these things come on. So some of the people work on joint replacements, plates, artificial ligaments, heart valves, contact lenses. Again, the issues that you're interested here from a materials perspective are, is the material stable? Does it react with something? Is it biocompatible? And if you're designing for applications related to drug delivery, injecting in our body, is the drug released from these materials that you have designed in a controlled fashion? Can you engineer materials where the drug is being released in a manner that you want it to be released? Okay. The last bit is called synthetic biology, which is something that's recently cropped up. Because now with technology, you have the power to manipulate DNA itself. Okay. Now we can genetically engineer organisms, right? We can add something so that a bacteria starts producing ethanol and so on and so forth. You can sort of do all sorts of things. So this is sort of engineering bacteria to produce ethanol, butanol. You can produce antibiotics. You can design biosensors. People are doing all sorts of things with this. This is called synthetic biology because these features in bacteria do not exist in nature, but this is something that you're adding from the outside. Okay. And the last bit is where does synthetic biology stop? Okay. So very recently, there was a creation of a bacterial cell controlled by chemically synthesized genome. So somebody in the US actually made a bacterial cell by himself. Okay. So now you are entering into the realm of playing God. You are creating live bugs in your lab. So while it's scientifically, technically possible, lots of other ethical issues and regulatory issues associated with it that need to be looked at, before we really understand synthetic biology. So that's the kind of flavor of the problems that are being done in biology, and they say that biology, 21st century is biology's century, because really the technical sort of innovations are allowing you to do things that would not have been possible even a few decades back. So the kind of problems that you can deal with, the kind of manipulations to the systems that you can make an engineer, they are unprecedented today, and they will keep on changing in the coming decades as well. Okay. So now our department, 9 or 10 people who are sort of exclusively work in the area related to biomaterials or bioengineering, and there are a few others which I have listed separately who actively collaborate with people who are working in biology, but their core research interests lie elsewhere. So in one slide each, I'll try to give you a flavor of what each person does in the department. But before we go there, any questions? Yeah. There's no one answer to that. Okay. It depends on the kind of problem that you're dealing with. One of the things is that beauties and notoriety of biology is that every system is very unique in itself. So you would need to define the system by itself. There is no generic system that you can go and work with. So while there are softwares available for metabolic engineering, for if you want to simulate the whole cell by itself, there are software available for that. If you're interested in names, come see me after that. Okay. But really, it depends on what is it that you're trying to do. Are you trying to understand metabolism, regulation, signaling? What is it that you're trying to do? Okay. So you heard Venkatesh, and the premise of his work is basically connecting genotype to phenotype, which is he's interested in engineering systems are quantified to a level. He wants to pick systems that exist in living cells and then understand them at a quantitative level and not at a qualitative level. Give it numbers, try to understand the quantitative behavior of these systems. Basically, this is employing principles from system science and applying them to biology. And again, some of the issues that he's interested in is some of the things that we talked about in systems slide, which is robustness, sensitivity, adaptiveness, and so on and so forth. And some of the specific problems that he's working on are human metabolism, especially what happens in the case of disease. Diabetes is one of the diseases that he looks at. Cellular models for simple bacteria. Can we model the entire cell by itself? Can we develop a mathematical model that explains an entire cell, simple bacterial cells, and chemotaxis in bacteria, which is how they sense gradients and move in particular directions. Sarika's lab is sort of interested in both experimental and computational aspects, and some of the problems are basically treating cell as chemical factories. Again, going back to the concept that we are going to treat the cell as a reactor, and can we play around with the system so as to enhance production of chemicals of interest, which in her case are antibodies. And this is done at different levels. One is you manipulate inside the cell, right? Second is you manipulate the conditions in which your cells are growing. Give it more media, higher temperature, lower temperature. And the third is sort of you design the reactor in such a way so as to, so there is optimization happening at various levels to be able to maximize production of anything that you are interested in. Then she is interested in how do bacteria respond in conditions of stress, mechanisms of antibiotic resistance in bacteria, and elucidation of cellular networks. Like there is a large mess of network that we started the talk with. Can we draw some underlying, you know, lessons from this? Is there a simpler way to understand and make some sense out of what we are looking at right there? Pramod's group is primarily interested in cyanobacteria, which are bacteria which can do photosynthesis. So they can capture atmospheric carbon dioxide and convert that into biomass. So he's looking at them again, engineering them with the objective of producing biomass from atmospheric CO2 and in the yielding bioenergy. So again, he's interested in bioenergy, production of chirally pure chemicals, because living organisms there's nothing more sensitive to selecting one chiral molecule over the other as a living cell, right? So this is a great way to select chiral molecules. And then doing fermentation, which is again modeling, optimization, and monitoring. Optimization again at various levels, at a cellular level, at the conditions level, and again at the reactor level. This is my group. So the basic question that I'm interested in is that if I ask you to build a ship, right, what would you do? How do you even start with that? Right, you would probably draw a sketch and then worry about things, right? And then once you start with the assembly process, you would then think of that. You wouldn't start with building the mast first, right? You would start with the base, and there is a sequence and hierarchy that's incorporated in building of a ship, right? So when you are building a ship, there is a foreman of the construction company that you gave the tender to, who will look after these things that mast is not constructed before the base of the boat, right? In bacteria, making these, we looked at flagella and there are others. All the information is contained in DNA, right? DNA is the blueprint of life. But where is the foreman? Who in bacteria tells that, okay, assemble this last bit at the end, assemble everything else first? Where is the foreman in bacteria? Okay. So that's the basic premise. Some of the questions are theoretical questions of evolution of networks, how do cells count, and control of gene expression in bacteria with particularly pathogens. Santosh's group works in bioprocess development and bioinformatics, and overall themes include integrated bioprocess development. So much like what Sarika and Pramod, again, optimization at different levels to maximize production of some protein or metabolite. Again, he also is also engaged in bioinformatics, which is application of statistical techniques towards learning patterns in biological data. I know he works with a lot of sequence data for patients who have cancer, and try to identify the exact mutations which are actually, can we learn something from that data, is one of the questions that he is looking at. What do you understand by noise? Or stochasticity? What is that? It's an unwanted signal, sure. And stochasticity? Probabilistic, right. So let me ask you this. You know, let's say I'm standing stationary here, and there is a balloon which is diffusing freely inside this room, okay? Up and down, there's no gravity, it's just random motion. When is it going to hit me? Probably after a very long time, right? So I note the time at which it hits me, and I do that experiment again. I stand here again, release the balloon again. Again, I wait for when the balloon hits me. This time I'm going to get a very different time at which the balloon hits me. I keep recording these times. I repeat this experiment. What do you think? The times that I get at the end of each experiment, are they going to be very same or very different? Very different, right? Now let's do the experiment again, but now instead of one balloon, you have 1,000 balloons in the room. And as soon as any one of those 1,000 hits me, I record the time. And again, I repeat this experiment with these 1,000 balloons and keep recording the times, right? Again, I'm going to get very different answers. Is the variability going to be less in this case or more in this case? Less in this case. Why? Right, it's because of the numbers. Because there was one molecule, the chance that it would hit me was very small. That would lead to variation in the behavior that I would observe every time I do the experiment. As the numbers increase, the behavior of the experiment consolidates towards a mean value. Okay, so Ganesh's group is actually looking at that stochasticity or noise or fluctuations which are caused by random nature of biochemical reactions and by variations in environmental conditions for a signaling system which is of importance when you're talking of cancer in human cells. Okay. So this is both experimental and computational work. Of course, this stochasticity affects decision made by cells. This TNF-alpha is an anti-cancer drug treatment, which is the system that he's looking at. This is both experimental modeling. So you do stochastic modeling, deterministic modeling. Stochastic modeling is when you account for this noise. Deterministic model is when you treat if everything was behaving the same. And again, working out the dynamics of the system and so on and so forth. Jayesh's work, so now we are moving towards the biomaterials group in the department. Jayesh's group works in nanotechnology based biomaterials for tissue engineering. Biomaterials and bioreactors form maximum expansion of stem cells, which are undifferentiated cells in human body. Developing scaffolds for synthetic bone substitutes, cell growth, essentially using nanocomposites as synthetic. You will know, I guess, nanocomposites in one of the later talks in the coming days. Sameer's group is again working on the broad themes of cell mechanics, biomaterials, and drug delivery. Specific problems are liposome synthesis and cellular uptake for applications which are related to drug delivery. Again, you want to design something which would release the drugs in a controlled manner, the way you want it to be released. Cell biomaterial interactions under simulated blood flow, and modeling and simulation of microfluidic devices. So microfluidic devices are used to study one cell at a time. Again, it's not enough. So this is both experimental fabrication and simulations which are related to understanding flow patterns in these microfluidic devices that he uses for these applications. And last is sir Abhijit, whose works in signaling and stem cell fate, and the problems that he is interested in is understanding mechanosensing and the role of mechano signals in determining stem cell fate, microfluidic design to study cellular behavior, very sort of similar with what Sami does, and adhesion and soft mechanics related applications. Okay. So thank you for listening to me, and I'll be happy to take questions. That's a contentious issue. My short reply would be, we don't even know, because the rate at which these things are moving, there is no poise, sort of, we're not waiting to find out what is the bad effect, what could be the adverse effects of this. These could potentially have impacts which are going to show up 100 years down the line, 200 years. Nobody has that kind of time and space in this world to wait and see what would happen. We're just going blindly. I have no idea what's going to happen. Okay, if there are no questions, I'll stop.
Okay, so next, say about 20 minutes or so, what we want to do is, I would like to invite faculty colleagues from our department, my department, who are working in this area, and those of you who are, you have seen actually their one slide for their work. Now you may have questions, you may have you know, right from fundamental questions is what chemical engineers are doing here in this area, to specific questions in these areas. So there's an open session in which I encourage you to talk to the faculty. You can ask your questions, you can ask your doubts, you can ask your, you know, curiosities. So I invite Professor Venkatesh, Professor Ganesh, Samir Jadhav, and Professor Abhijit Majumdar, and Supreet, of course, is here. So, please, this is a session in which you should talk. After every talk, we have a session for about 30 to 40 minutes in which there's an open interaction with the faculty in the department. Okay. So, please ask your questions, ask your doubts. As you can see that, you know, maybe in the last century, chemical engineers were behind making chemicals, understanding. So there are hundreds and millions of chemicals, thousands of chemicals which chemical engineers are involved in making. So what we have found is, we have found a system in making them, and we are able to apply you know, ideas of systems engineering to making of chemicals. Now we are after making of biochemicals, you know, we are after cells. So we have changed the domain from chemicals to biochemicals and entered a new phase. So whatever questions you have, so we want these sessions to be a lively sessions. Please go ahead and ask whatever questions you have. So we'll pass the mic here. So you have to talk, not just stay silent. whatever questions you have had from this.
If you don't have questions, then I mean, we will start asking questions.
Yeah.
The stem cells are used for the healing of the some severe diseases, like a brain, brain surgery. Sometimes it's stem cells are used.
Right.
How much they are effective?
Okay. Is it
all?
Okay, so the answer depends on like which type of disease you would like to address. I would say for like diseases like blood cancer or like blood related diseases, we are like quite there, we are far ahead. This is considering other diseases, we are not yet there. So if I consider like blood related diseases, yes, using stem cells therapy, we can cure or like manage a lot of them. In terms of bone and muscle related diseases, we are doing well, but I mean, those things are in the clinical stage. in terms of treating eye-related diseases like your some kind of corneal diseases, we are, I mean, being able to make this thing cornea using stem cells, and like the treatment is very much there. Other kind of diseases, they are like more still in the you know, the lab phase, or more like this conceptual phase. They have not, I mean, progressed so far. So it is like the answer is like at the various level. Thanks.
See, noise need not necessarily be seen as a undesirable aspect. Sometimes it helps and sometimes it doesn't help. So for example, the way our immune system works, like whenever we get disease, whenever we get cold, for example, I'm sure all of you must have heard from your mama that you know, if you take medicines, you will get cured in 1 week. If you don't take medicines, you'll get cured in 7 days. I mean, it's a common joke that's played. But the point here is that the body is able to recognize what kind of pathogen actually has come into the body and it has affected our system. Now, it does not know a priori that this particular pathogen is going to come. So without that knowledge, the body is able to learn what is the pathogen and you can fight against it. So the way it works is that when the DNA is replicated in one of the types of cells, immune cells, I'll not go into the details. What happens is that this variation in terms of the copying machinery, what Supreet had mentioned, so this copying machinery makes a mistake deliberately. In that particular situation, it's made to make mistake deliberately, and that mistake makes it to copy many different types of cells. And one of these cells randomly will match the DNA of the pathogen, and that's how it recognizes. So that in this situation, it actually helps the host system to fight against a pathogen. In some other system, for example, if there is in cancer cells, if you have noise in cancer cells, what happens is that the ability to fight actually is completely destroyed, because the body is able to recognize certain types of bad cells or cells which are not desirable. But then if the cells are able to incorporate noise and create different cells in the same environment, then the immune system will not be able to fight, and that's one of the mechanisms that has been suggested for cancer. So mitigation is basically you want to suppress this differences that is caused because of the internal machinery and the differences that is caused because of environmental effects on the system. On the other hand, sometimes you want to take advantage of it. And so the question is, what situation you want to take advantage, and what situation you do not want to take advantage. So that's basically where it stands now.
As a man evolved from four leg to two leg, why haven't other animals evolved in such a way?
I have no idea. Seriously, no idea.
See, a lot of this debate is basically a debate of gaps, you know, the creationists and the evolutionists. Evolution is still a theory. It's not been proved. Okay, it's been proved in parts. So there are a lot of gaps, and that's why you have creationists who will always question. So there are a spectrum of, if you ask people in their beliefs, even science in a way is beliefs until you see the experimental data. So the experiment you are asking is not being done.
Our backbone will be direct. This is just one gene duplication and a mutation in that one. Okay, so indirectly to answer your question, there is a random process which took place. The gene got duplicated, there was a mutation in that gene, and then our back became direct. So that forced us, you know, to stand on two legs. So it's a process, it's a evolutionary process. Cannot say that why other animals are not. Because
the system got altered. Okay, the system design got altered because of duplication and mutation. You can never prove evolution. Evolution will never be proved. And all you need is one counter example that would make all of evolution collapse. So people are trying, but because they can't find it, but you can never prove everything. There was an experiment maybe a century back in Russia where they started with wolves, and you know they sort of domesticated it. Dogs are from wolves. And within 7 generations or so, the wolves were started to not only just behave, they would only feed if they were started being docile and dog-like. So within 7 generations, they said that not only the behavior, but also the physical appearance has changed. And you were selecting for basically dog-like features or something. Maybe if they held the food higher or something.
And then when you say that you were half a whole day, you were 2 days, so that was the kind of consequence of the same problem.
Now current scenario is that new drugs, this new drug molecule become easy. First, delivery is too challenging. How to deliver the molecules, the new molecules, to reduce the toxicity? And you are working on the chromatography system. Now, how much strength and how it was to deliver the new drugs into the body?
So, also, that's the challenge. Like, you know, sort of cure is not available for everything. So it's a mix and match to a specific disease. And there are different ways in which it is being addressed. The same disease is being addressed by different methods. Okay, as well as you want to have some generality in the sense that you want to apply one method to many diseases also. So, there are liposomal systems in the market. They work well, okay. But it's not very general. So it's only for a specific drug they will work. The question is, how do we design a system in which we can then control as to how much of the drug goes to a specific kind of a cell. So the selectivity of the cell, the control of the timing in terms of when it is delivered, all of these things require careful design. So this process is. Yes. Right, because the liposomal system, I mean, to assemble it, it depends on the properties of the drug molecule itself. So apart from that, you also want to know in that particular disease, if you want to target it, then how do you target it to that specific cell? So once you change the molecular structure, the stability of the carrier and the drug, that assembly, that changes. So the idea is to test for these, for a specific disease, or at least bring up a class of diseases for which you want to make a delivery system.
So a class, good example of that would be some of the cancer treatments. Some of you may have seen that, you know, the chemotherapy. I mean, some of you may have heard this name, this word. So there are generally broadly two classifications. One is like the general chemotherapy and the other one is like a specific chemotherapy. So in fact, the general chemotherapy, you will see that the person will have hair will fall everywhere, all fast growing cells will be destroyed. So that's actually a very strong side effect. Now in a specific chemotherapy, one of the ways it is being addressed is by using a specific liposomal type drug delivery. Now that depends on which type of cancer. Even for the same tissue, there are different mechanisms as to why the cancer has occurred. And depending upon which mechanism, the drug that is used is different. And some of these drugs are hypersensitive and some of them are not. So it's actually a two-pronged question, which carrier to use, and also are there alternative medicines which are not hypersensitive? So if they're hypersensitive, they'll kill the carrier and it'll have severe side effects, and which is absolutely undesirable. So the objective would be to cure the disease, but with minimal side effects, as minimal as possible. So it's a two-pronged question in my mind.
It
don't think in our department we are looking at least in this department it's not, but yeah, but bio department maybe they might, but in this department we are not looking at it.
Yeah, so essentially we have modeled the system. So because we look at it as an engineering system, okay. So what biologists and the studies in the past have given is the components inside the cells which are responsible, say for example, glucose uptake. So Supreet was saying that, you know, as soon as there is an environmental change, the cells recognize something, and then there is a series of reactions that take place, and then some genes are switched on, and product, okay, is there, and then you have some transporters go to the surface and the glucose is taken in, right? For example, as soon as glucose level goes up, insulin is secreted. And as soon as insulin is secreted, it goes to all the tissues, say for example, muscle. Then there are transporters of glucose which is sent to the surface and the glucose goes in. So it's an elaborate signaling network that has to be incorporated and analyzed. The dynamics of that has to be analyzed. So we have developed a reaction model for insulin secretion and how the transporters goes to the surface. So it is a combination of transport, reaction, everything included. It's a multi-scale model. And so you try to now predict and perturb, okay. And for example, so first you develop a model and you have a quantitative model. And next you do some analysis. For example, in engineering we are used to input-output relationship, right. So you apply voltage and you measure a current. So then you can plot that voltage is the input and current is the output, right. So this is the input-output, steady state input-output. So I can do the same thing. So I can now say that, you know, insulin is the input. So what is the amount of glucose, what is the rate at which glucose is going in is the current, equivalent of current. So I plot this input-output, right. So in disease states, how this input-output gets altered. So there is one protein called as, I mean, you need not have to know the details, but there is one protein called as PTPase. So if you just double it, I mean, it has got a concentration of say 0.5 micromoles inside the cell. So it becomes 1 micromole in the cell. So this input-output relationship, what we have got, completely gets shifted to the right. So what it is saying is that one single perturbation in a protein in the signaling network demands higher amounts of insulin. So your insulin is physiologically normal. So there's nothing wrong with your amount of insulin that is produced. But what has changed is the characteristics of the way the signaling network is working. So we can ask such questions. So which protein is, you know, this network is sensitive to, or the performance of the network is sensitive to which protein? And that could be a drug target, for example, because that is the most sensitive network. So we have extended this model to include, you know, the whole cell, whole body metabolism in humans. For example, how diet affects, you know, a diabetic state. So if somebody is taking a lot of fat, okay, or somebody is taking a lot of protein into their diet, so how does this network behave? You know, does the performance, you know, or the sensitivity change? So lifestyle affects, you know, exercise, how does it affect? Okay, so these kind of questions we are asking after we have developed a model.
Okay. So yes, so basically it's basically creation of synthetic bone. In the sense, what happens is whenever you have a fracture and then some parts of the bone are shattered, then you want it to grow back. Now there is under natural conditions it will grow back only up to a certain extent. Now there are two things to it. One is you actually want it to grow back and you want it to grow back faster. In such cases, you use these nanocomposites as bone substitutes or even as scaffolds in which the bone cells grow. So, it's been used in basically whenever there is a break, like arthritis is a joint disease. So in such a case, you would just replace it. You could technically make the material of but right now even the metallic joints, they work fine. But eventually you would want it to be as natural as possible, where the cells are able to grow into the scaffold and it becomes a natural joint rather than an artificial joint. So this is work which is Professor Jayesh Billare. So he is working on those ceramic nanocomposites. So he's also using some of that for dental work. So no, these are not biodegradable. They are biocompatible. So those are being used as bone substitutes, yes.
So it can be effective for drug delivery?
If it is not biodegradable, then it's not useful for drug delivery. But if you're looking for a bone substitute, then you don't want it to degrade, right? You want it to have its strength. That I'm not aware of. Professor Jayesh Bellare's group, they're working on that area.
Now, in
human
anatomy, there are modified DNA, okay? Then how we can check that DNA modified?
You can check.
There should be a level scale.
So there are techniques available where you can easily synthesize DNA. So you may say sequence. DNA is a polymer of ATGC. Are the monomers. So you say you may want this particular sequence. So you get it synthesized, there are synthesizers, and then you, whatever you end up with, you may send it for sequencing. Sequencing is a check that what is the actual sequence in this sample that I'm sending you. Then you get back the results and then you compare with what you wanted, right? So you confirm that you, what you have got is what you wanted. And then once you have that piece of DNA, then you can plant it inside the cell and do any manipulation for which you designed that piece of DNA. You don't look very happy.
Not convinced.
No.
We get the actual quantity of that GC or CG.
Right. Right.
But the sequence means G modded with C.
Right. Yeah, that's double stranded, and this is RNA. U is not in DNA.
So
it's
in RNA.
Okay. Oh,
if I want ATGC, GC, GC,
A. Specific
it
sequence.
It's not perfectly known by the test. You can read the only quantity of how many ATs are there and GCs are there.
You get the sequence.
You can find out what is the order in which it is aligned.
DNA is a directional molecule. There is a 5' prime end and a 3' prime end. So you get the exact sequence that if when I read from 5' prime to 3', prime, what is the order in which these ATGCs appear? So you get that sequence. That's what you mean when you say that you've got the sequence. You get the order as well as how many of A's, how many T's. You get both the information.
One final.
Yeah.
So pegylated liposomes also are used for drug delivery, and you want to know the chemical synthesis? So that is a chemical bond, so that there is this NHS group to which you have the COH react, and that's how you do the pegylation. But these are available in market. The pegylated phospholipids, they are already available in market. So you can buy them directly and then prepare your liposomes from that. Yes. Right, right.
Bio?
Biofuels.
Oh, biofuels.
There are two levels at which the biofuel work is happening. One is basically looking at how to engineer microorganisms towards producing a certain type of fuels. Precursors, I wouldn't say directly fuels. Now, there's also a reaction engineering group, you will see it later, where they're looking at how to convert these precursors into actual fuel use. So it depends on what you want to know. I mean, both these areas are available. Directly, I don't think there's
biogas. There is a separate department, center right? For environmental science and engineering. So we have a CESC where you have some studies in biogas. Not in our department.